In today's video, I'm gonna have a look at the newest in a long line of Nvidia's noob beta 9000s. And funnily enough, I was actually baited by this graphics card. The other day, I was shopping for graphics cards and noticed some RTX 3050s selling for 220 Canadian dollars, which seemed like a great deal to me. I was legitimately really excited to see that. But then I noticed that it just has 6 gigs of video memory, which was not the amount I remembered them having. So I googled it and realized that it's not an RTX 3050, if anything, it's an RTX 3040. So in today's video, I'm gonna see how slow this thing actually is and to what depths the RTX nameplate has plunged. But first, today's video is sponsored by boot.dev, a great way for even a complete noob to learn back-end web development in both Python and Go programming languages. And with boot.dev's focus on the gamification of learning, not only is the process very engaging, but it also gets you to write a ton of actual code, nothing like some practical learning. And for those of you that feel like you need a community for learning, boot.dev has a very active Discord community with a bunch of people willing to help if you ever get stuck on particular problems. And there are even community events like bi-monthly boss battles where the community rallies together and gets bonus XP for every lesson they complete. So if you want to learn some valuable programming skills, check out boot.dev with the link down below and use code Dawid for 25% off your first month or even first year if you choose annual billing. Now I'm always excited about a new budget graphics card, but this 6GB RTX 3050 is pretty much a masterclass in how to turn something exciting into something that's a family-ruining traumatic experience. This is kind of like giving your kid socks on Christmas. It's outrageous, because not only does your video memory drop from 8GB to 6GB with a smaller memory bus, but the GPU in here is also cut down quite significantly. It's cut down so significantly, in fact, that Nvidia thought it was appropriate for them to call the GPU something different. The GPU die in the 8GB variant of the RTX 3050 is called the GA106, whereas in the 6GB variant of the 3050, it's called the GA107. Yeah, I mean, here's a handy rule of thumb for you, Nvidia. If you feel like the GPU die warrants a different name, the graphics card warrants a different name. It's not really difficult. Like, if they just called it the RTX 3040, it would have been a lot more exciting, because on the surface, it's got some stuff going for it. Its drop in TDP, for example, means that it doesn't need supplemental power. So low-profile versions of these GPUs are much more versatile than its more power-hungry brothers. But anyway, let's put my disgruntled ramblings aside and drop this graphics card into a system to see what kind of performance we get out of it and how it compares to its bigger brother. Now, in terms of the system I'm testing it in, I've got a Ryzen 9 5900X in there with 16 gigs of DDR4 running at 3600 megahertz. So with that, let's see how it performs. Damn, I thought these gaming X cards were like good versions of GPUs, but this is one step of build quality away from just being a scam Wish graphics card. Oh, I love the little stoppers that keep the backplate from overbending. And they're not screwed down, look at that. Stellar build quality aside, the RTX 3040, and I'm gonna call it that from now on because it's much less stupid, in a vacuum, performs pretty well. This is CS2 running at 1080p low settings, and for an esports title like this, it's very usable. I mean, look at that, it's well over 300 frames per second. And because of its low power draw, despite the janky cooler, the temperatures are very good on the card, and it's pretty quiet. Moving over to Doom Eternal at 1080p high settings, again, a very respectable result here. Even if you have a higher refresh rate display, this'll cut it. And despite the more consistent higher load on the GPU, the temperatures didn't bat an eye. However, with a more demanding game like Cyberpunk at 1080p medium settings, it really starts to struggle consistently staying below 60 frames per second. Now, considering that the 3040 is an RTX GPU, we get access to some DLSS action. And interestingly, in Cyberpunk, when comparing DLSS and Fidelity FX at the same settings, not only did DLSS visually look a bit better, even if it wasn't a huge difference, DLSS looked a bit less fuzzy. But I even got a higher frame rate, which I wasn't expecting. This is something I'll test in more detail later in the video, but first let's get the base performance comparison out of the way. But either way, even without upscaling, at 1080p, the 3040 does a reasonable job at gaming, although when it comes to more demanding modern games like The Last of Us at 1080p medium, it starts to struggle a little. The game felt all molasses-y. But how does it compare to the graphics card which name it stole? A direct comparison to the real RTX 3050 is not flattering. It starts off with a reasonably gentle comparison in Counter-Strike, where we're seeing about a 10-ish percent performance difference. It is worth noting that in Counter-Strike 2, the 3040 uses proportionally quite a bit less power, so there's a reasonable bit of efficiency on show here. But as the games start asking more of the graphics cards, the gap keeps getting bigger. With Doom Eternal, not only is the average performance quite a bit better, we see a reasonable jump in 1% lows, which makes it feel a lot smoother. And with Cyberpunk is the first time we see that performance difference taking the gaming experience from feeling a bit thick to being perfectly playable. So depending on the game, there really is a name change worthy performance delta between these two graphics cards. And when comparing the RTX 3040 to a similarly priced-ish AMD graphics card, the RX 6500 XT, the comparison becomes more favorable, but that card was pretty butt cheeks when it came out, only has 4 gigs of video memory, and doesn't have a video encoder, so you can't screen capture footage with it. Oh, and it also wildly soiled its diapers in Doom Eternal for some reason. But despite being more lethargic than its bigger brother, it still isn't the slowest RTX graphics card. That achievement still lies squarely in the hands of the laptop RTX 2050, which is still a whole lot more rubbish than our new little RTX 3040. So now that we've confirmed this is a genuine case of stolen identity, let's circle back around and see if DLSS is a feature that makes this graphics card a decent bit more exciting, or if the Cyberpunk situation was a fluke. I thought it would be interesting to start off with some Ratchet and Clank, which here looks very weird. Like, what's up with his face? What's going on here? But either way, at 1080p medium settings, we're getting about 60 frames per second here. Now let's see what happens when we turn on the lowest settings available for ray tracing. And straight off the bat, we've lost half our frame rate, which very much tracks for ray tracing. That's often what happens. The game still looks very weird. I guess things are more bloomy and kind of bright. If anything, it's just blinding me now. Next, let's crank them ray tracing settings. And surprisingly, that's had a much less dramatic impact on the performance. And I don't know, visually it looks so similar to me. Anyway, let's see to what extent DLSS can save us here. Let's do balanced. Wait a minute, DLSS just fixed all that visual weirdness. If anything, it made a bigger improvement to the visuals than turning on ray tracing did. I guess it's because we're running 1080p on a 1440p display. But either way, we've also gotten more performance, so win-win all round. Let's see what happens when we jump to performance. Yeah, I don't know, it doesn't look that much worse. Even the streamers and stuff, like particle effects, are being handled decently. Although we're not getting that much more performance. But anyway, either way, let's compare it to FSR. So we'll switch over to FSR 3 with performance. Whoa, the quality difference is pretty big. With FSR, you lose some of the particle effects like the streamers and stuff in the upscaling process, which doesn't happen with DLSS. And when there's a bunch of movement like around this flag, there's a lot more artifacting happening with FSR. Ooh, that's fascinating considering that this is a PS5 game, but at least there isn't a performance difference between the two. And luckily, Ratchet & Clank also has Intel's upscaling, so let's give that a try.
Whoa, I mean, clearly Intel is drunk or something because,
oh, it just fixed itself. Okay, that was just a bit of a seizure, but it's over now. But now that it's woken up from its drunken stupor. So Intel seems to be like a middle ground between the two. When you're looking at a static shot, it looks similar to DLSS, but when you start moving around, everything kind of blurs in the way that it does with FSR. But with that, let's try one more game to see if this is a trend. Now, the final game I want to play around with is The Last of Us, because recently I figured out that it's got a pretty good DLSS implementation. Now here, it's running at the same settings I used for the testing before, so this is 1080p medium. And we're actually running at 1080p here, and 40 frames per second. It's not doing amazingly. Now, one of the cool things about The Last of Us is it shows you what the rendered resolution is. So with balanced DLSS, it drops from 1080p to 1120 by 632. And in terms of performance, that gives us a lot more. So we've gone from about 40 to about 60, and the game feels way better. And again, like,
Despite this being what looks like quite a difficult scene to upscale, I don't think I can tell DLSS is on. It looks really good. I wonder if it's the same for Fidelity FX. It is. I don't think I can see the difference. It looks so similar, which, I mean, that's a tie, right? If it performs the same and it looks the same, it's functionally the same. Interestingly, Balanced on the 2 uses a slightly different resolution. So next we're gonna go more aggressive with it. So we're gonna drop it from Balanced down to Performance. Oh, it still looks so similar to me. Now when zoomed in on the screenshots, it looks a bit fuzzy in Performance, but I still can't tell the difference between FSR and DLSS here. And in game, they both look and feel very good. Although the cracks are starting to show with things like that fence wobbling in the distance and just some general upscaling artifacts. Oh, interestingly, DLSS only goes down to Performance in this game. So if you really want to wreck your image quality, you have to go back over to FSR. And then I want to go all in. So we're going to turn frame generation on as well. Oh, it's starting to look rubbish now and it's starting to feel pretty heavy, but we've got a lot of frame rate. So let's crack the normal settings, which it's super not happy about in terms of that. Oh, the mush is coming. And oh, look at that line. Look at that. And aside from that, there's also a decent amount of input lag. Oh! So the only way we can make it look worse now is by dropping the display resolution, which does some wild things to the rendered resolution. Okay, now don't get me wrong, it looks like my cat threw up this video game on the display, but considering what's happening here, we've got a 1440p display and the rendered resolution is like 3x4, it could have been a hell of a lot worse. It really isn't that bad. So with that, whether or not the new Beta 9000 gives you cheap access to DLSS as a selling point or not, I guess depends very much on the game you're playing. So with that, thank you for watching, subscribe and watch another video suggestion will pop up in a second, and until the next one, bye-bye.